This broadcast is presented in 4K HDR Ultra High Definition. Presented by Horns and Hooves Entertainment, you are watching Buffalo After Dark.
Hey everybody, welcome to Buffalo After Dark. It is episode 99 here. Woo! On July 27th, 2022. Of course, Tom and Bob are here. We're here for the next hour, and Sean's going to be joining us a little bit later. But one of the big things that happened, we weren't on last week because the man next to me right here decided to take that walk down the aisle and got himself hitched and married.
Fuck yeah, let's go.
Yeah, so first and foremost, man, congrats. I'm glad everything went well with it, and good to see everything, you know, happen, you know, the way it did. I mean, it did kind of suck for family reasons. I was not able to go last minute, but everything at least worked out on that side. But on the flip side, though, man, you had a good time at your wedding, and everything went well.
Thank you, Tom. I appreciate that. And by the way, thanks for the introduction. And yeah, it was great. I mean, I got to tell you, it's very hard to describe the wedding to someone who was not there, only for the fact that it was considered a spiritual experience. That's the quotation I got from some people. And of course, my wife's not here right now. She went out for a little bit, but she'll be back in a little while. But no, so my wife and I have been getting a lot of, you know, comments about saying, you know, of all the weddings I've been to, including some of our own, this is hands down the best one we've been into. It really was, like, there was not even a dry eye in that entire house. Everybody was sobbing, was crying, you name it. They were just having a blast. We had one speech, which was from my brother. He was the best man, so he did his best man speech. And then we just kind of just, you know, partied on for the rest of our lives, basically. Nice. And I didn't really get to say hello to everybody because I was getting pulled for like interviews and photo shoots, etc. So outside of that, nobody really felt bad because I'm like, you know, I felt bad. And it's like, no, don't worry. It was your wedding. You know, you got to go get those photos taken. It's like, all right, if that's how you feel.
Yeah. Well, definitely, you know, first and foremost, man, congrats. I mean, and of course, I mean, I've known you for a long time now. I've known Brittany for a long time now too. So, you know, it's good stuff. And then I'm going to be making my way down there at the end of the year. So we'll be doing that. And then of course, I'll be bringing my other half with me. So that'll be good. And then basically, you know, we'll enjoy a few days together down there and probably catch a game. So that'll be a good thing.
Oh yeah.
But I gotta tell you, you know, it's good for you. And the other thing too, I am sending you guys something in the mail, just so you know, so keep an eye out for it.
Oh, definitely. I'll ask you about that later for sure.
Yeah, no worries. But yeah, once I get paid on Friday, then it'll go out. So definitely keep an eye out for it. But in the meantime, we got a lot of stuff to talk about over the next like 45 minutes or so. So if you want to call in, 929-205-6099 gets you on the air. And then, of course, Joey Hatch, welcome to the show. I appreciate you being here. And I know he's actually one of our guys. He actually messaged me offline. So he's someone that likes to follow us quite a bit. But let's get right into it. NHL trades, there's been a few big ones that have happened over the last week or so.
Okay. Well, if there was one thing I was praying to God for, not that I was thinking it was going to happen, but it did, was I asked for one prayer from the hockey gods, and they did not even bother into my consideration, and that was, I asked the hockey gods to not make any big splashes on the night of my wedding. And what the fuck did they do? They do not yep. one, but two trades on the night of my wedding. One during the cocktail hour and one during the night.
Yeah, so I'll give you the honors, man, because you're no longer a solo person. So let's talk about the first of the big two.
All right, so the first of the big two. Oh, man, I got to tell you, when I saw this trade, I got the notification on Twitter. That's the only reason I knew this trade even happened. So the trade, if you haven't seen it, was a pretty big cap dump, if you ask me. So the Columbus Blue Jackets have decided to trade forward Oliver Bjornstrand, one of their best top six forwards, to the Seattle Kraken in exchange for a 2023 third round pick and a 2023 fourth round pick. And this is solely based on the fact that they paid $16 million to Eric the Pylon DeBranson. So because of that hideous contract, they now had to get rid of one of their best scorers to an expansion team.
Oh, well, Seattle, good for you for making that happen. And I know one thing, Sean's very happy about that trade.
Mm-hmm.
But good job, Seattle, because I'll tell you, I mean, they've been making some really nice moves in this offseason. I mean, they want to be legit contenders coming through like season two, season three. So awesome job on that. I mean, now Columbus, yeah, you got Johnny Gaudreau, which, I mean, yeah, great signing for you, but why would you keep the pylon?
Yeah, I mean, seriously. Well, he was a free agent, so they brought him in, I guess, to comfort Johnny Gaudreau, I guess. I mean, I also know that they brought back Patrick Laine for another extra 4 years. I forgot how much they paid him, but it was a hefty amount of money. So Patrick Laine even said that this is the most excited I've been playing hockey since, you know, I got drafted. And so he's going to get a chance to play with Johnny Hockey in the small city of Columbus, Ohio.
Yeah. But
I just find it interesting. The Kraken, of all teams, were willing to take on Bjorkstrand's contract, which is another 4 years. But didn't he just sign that contract like a year and a half ago?
I thought he did. And actually, to answer your question about Line A, it's a 4-year, $34.8 million extension.
Okay, that makes sense. But
I mean, he produced. I mean, they have 26 goals last season and basically 56 points. I mean, that's not a bad season.
No, it's not at all. And the funny thing is that, you know, I would have never thought in a million years Oliver Bjornstrand would be the one to be traded and not fucking, you know, anybody else for that matter. I mean, on the Columbus Blue Jackets, I thought if they kept Bjornstrand, I figured that they were going to be a contender for a while, a fringe playoff team. But I'm not too sure now, because if they kept Bjornstrand with the extra scoring, I definitely think that they would have been much of a fringe contender this year in the playoffs than they would have been to miss it. I mean, the Columbus Blue Jackets overall, that since they've been in the league, they're very hard to predict. They really, truly are.
Yeah, they're either all in and play well, or they absolutely suck. I mean, there's really no way to judge it, unfortunately. And I mean, I can't even give you a read on what's going to happen this season with all the moves. I would expect that they're going to play well, but I mean, who knows? I mean, they're a crapshoot.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to predict with Columbus. I mean, and the narrative for years was, oh, no big star wants to stay in Columbus. I want to go to LA or New York. That was always the narrative. But now that Johnny Gaudreau is coming to the Columbus Blue Jacket, it completely changes everything. And now, because of that cap hit with Gaudreau and then bringing in Gabranson, which I said was $16 million for 4 years, They had no choice. This was a salary cap dump, hands down. Because that was the only way they were going to keep Laine. And sure enough, they ended up trading him to the Kraken. And I think, and if I remember reading this correctly, Oliver Bjornstrand actually got traded on the day of his wedding.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Or at least on his honeymoon. It was either his wedding or his honeymoon. And I read that. I'm like, oh, poor guy. You get traded on the week of your honeymoon, and now you realize, oh, I just bought a house in Columbus. I'm like, well, now all that money that you saved up is now gone. You completely thrown out the window.
Right. Yeah, very true. But I mean, he's going to be one part of Seattle's line that has really improved in this offseason. I mean, they've done a great job with bringing in some free agents, but also their drafting's been pretty good.
Absolutely. And I think, in my opinion, the Kraken were one of the best teams in the draft, hands down, In terms of drafting and their system and all of that. I mean, they've also probably, in my opinion, to me, have the best broadcasting crew, because they also brought in Eddie Olczyk from the Chicago Blackhawks to be a color analyst.
I saw that, and that's going to really improve a lot of stuff for them too. So, I mean, and even last season when I was able to watch some of the games with ESPN Plus and some different platforms, I mean, they, even though Seattle was not winning a lot, they were actually pretty fun to watch.
Absolutely. And if you look at their top 12 or their top 9, you have Andre Burakovsky, Jared McCann, Jaden Schwartz, Brandon Tanev, Matty Beniers, Shane Wright, Yanni Gourde, Alex Wenberg, Jordan Eberle, Oliver Bjornstrand, and then Jonas Donskoy, and then they have a guy named Kuhlman, who I forget his name. I think his name is Sean Kuhlman, I'm pretty sure. And then on defense, you have Vince Dunn, Johan Larsson, Jamie Oleksiak, Justin Schultz, Carson Soucy, and Will Borgen. And then their 1-2 punch is Philip Grubauer and Martin Jones.
Yeah, I mean, they've really shored up a lot of stuff that they needed to after their first season. I mean, that's going to be a fun team out west to watch.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. But do I think they'll make the playoffs? I'm not sure. But I definitely think, though, they could definitely be competitive if they're healthy. I know Philip Grubauer didn't have the greatest season in the world, but then again, that's also what happens when you don't play on the freaking Avalanche or the Capitals.
Right. Yeah. But at the same time, I mean, they addressed a lot of their needs that they had. So, I mean, I think hands down one of the best drafts that I've seen in a while. And I mean, they took care of a lot of issues that they had. So right now they did addition by subtraction, basically.
And even crazier is they're now in the mix for Nazem Kadri again.
Which that's going to be interesting to see what happens too, because if they can land Kadri, all I can say is the West better watch out.
Yeah, they could be a force to be reckoned if they play their cards right.
Yeah, 100% true. 100% true. And then, of course, if you guys want to jump on, 929-205-6099 gets you on the air. And let's talk about the second big trade that came up.
And the second big trade that happened over the week is one that I would say is probably a sign of first of many to come for years, is there was a report over the week that Matthew Tkachuk was brutally honest about the Calgary Flames. And he said, I'm not staying in Calgary. I don't want to be here long term, but I do want to get paid. But I'm not staying in Calgary. So next thing you know, the Calgary Flames are in this debacle of, you know, craziness. And it's like, oh shit, what do we do now? We're about to lose Johnny Gaudreau and Matthew Tkachuk, because this whole thing is a fucking nightmare for the Calgary Flames this whole offseason. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's, I don't know how to describe this, but the fact is that the Calgary Flames lost both of their star players either by free agency or by trade. It's insane. The end.
Yeah, so, I mean, losing Gaudreau was bad enough, but then lose Tkachuk on top of it.
But let's talk about the deal. Man. Yeah, so this was supposedly the first ever sign and trade deal in the history of the NHL and one of the biggest blockbuster trades that we've seen in a long time. So for those who haven't read it, Matthew Tkachuk was traded to the Florida Panthers. That to me was like, holy shit. And to be honest, Tom, I didn't get a chance to digest this fully because obviously I was with my wedding and I was just settling in. Like, my whole weekend was surrounded by my wedding. So I didn't really get a chance to go, okay, what's going on here? So Matthew Tkachuk gets traded to the Florida Panthers and they return that the Flames get for him. Jonathan Huberto, Mackenzie Weegar, prospect Cole Schwinn, and a 2025 conditional first round pick, and that pick is top 10 protected.
And on top of that, Tkachuk agreed to an 8-year deal
for $9.7 million with the Florida Panthers.
Oh my God, Calgary, you just destroyed your franchise.
I don't agree with that. I think that, I know they're trying to be competitive with the post Gaudreau and Tkachuk era. I get it, but the value that Johnny Gaudreau is going to have on this trade, I think, will really say a lot. Mackenzie Weegar and Jonathan Huberto are both free agents at the end of this year. Then even if they don't resign, they can flip both of them for assets. And Huberto, you can get a really good deal like that. Mm-hmm. But same with Weegar. But the Calgary Flames, I think it really just depends on how everything plays out. Because if you take into account, there's a very strong chance that Huberto is going to be the replacement for Gaudreau for at least this season coming up, if he agrees to stay long-term in Calgary.
Right. Which, thinking about it, I had to laugh about it at first, because I'm like, why would you give up two of your best players like that? But
I mean, this could very, very well be a Jekyll and Hyde trade on both sides. But right. I think short-term, the Florida Panthers win this trade, hands down. Long-term, definitely the Calgary Flames, because they got a pretty decent good return for Tkachuk, unlike they got for Johnny Gaudreau, which was nothing, because Johnny Gaudreau was kept bitching and moaning, saying, I want to stay in Calgary. I want to win a cup here.
Yeah, and then he's like, oh, bye. I'm going to Columbus.
He basically pulled it to Tavares.
Yeah. Oh, I remember when that happened.
Oh, I was so pissed.
And then I remember when you were at the game, too, and how they were chanting everything.
Yep, we don't need you. Yeah. How do you think Flames fans are going to feel when Johnny Gaudreau comes back?
Oh, I'm thinking it's going to probably be a similar reaction to what Tavares got on his homecoming.
It's got to be.
Yeah.
Hey, Sean, what's up?
How's it going?
Gilliman, how's it going?
Good.
I'm good.
Yeah, our last new episode of season two, my friend.
Yeah, we're making this count. So we're actually just going over the two trades that happened over the week on the night of my wedding. Yeah, would you believe that?
Yeah, speaking of which, so what's it like being being a newlywed?
It's hard to describe, Sean. I will say that. It is very hard to describe because I haven't fully sunk it in all in just yet. I mean, my wife's not here right now, but
right,
I will say, though, I have the ring in my hand for the show specifically. So
nice.
So I want to just throw that out there. And it was a hell of an experience. And everybody was saying it was a spiritual experience. And there was not a dry eye in the entire building. I got to tell you, it's very hard to explain it for someone who isn't there. You know what I mean?
Gotcha. Well, you two were definitely made for each other. And, you know, congrats on your wedding. And I wish nothing but the best for you both.
I appreciate that, Sean. Thanks for the shout out, by the way.
Hey, no problem, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
here's a little fun thing, Sean. It's like basically got an idea here. And it's kind of similar to our Kansas City idea. So my plan is I'm going to go down to New York City and Long Island at the end of the year, because the nice thing is with where I work now, we automatically get the week between Christmas and New Year's off. So we get paid for it. I don't have to use vacation time or anything.
Nice.
But I am going to take a trip down there. Me and my other.
Okay.
So yeah, come on down.
Yeah, I'll try. I'll definitely try.
But we do have Kansas City at least.
Yeah, we still got that.
So that would be good stuff, man. But yeah, we were just talking a little bit about the NHL trades, and we were talking about the trade that happened between Calgary and Florida. And then right before that, we actually talked about Seattle getting a lot better.
Oh, yeah. Boy. Oh, my gosh. Thank you, Ron Francis.
Dude, that was a mega deal for Seattle. I think that's
for real.
I think that was the first big trade that they've made in the history ever. But
yeah, I was literally just watching highlights of Oliver Bjorkstrand. My gosh, this guy is so freaking good. Jeez. Yep.
And to think that they didn't even have to give up much for him either. They gave up 2 third-round picks in the next two drafts in 23 and 24 just to get a massive contract for 4 more seasons in Seattle. And your top six has completely changed like that in an instant with Bjorkstrand around.
Oh, man, that's even better. Yes.
Yeah, Seattle wins the trade hands down on that one.
And not for real.
And not to mention, they're also in on Nazem Kadri again.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, imagine paying for Nazem Kadri and getting Oliver Bjornstrand and Andrei Burakovsky all in the same offseason.
Good God.
That's going to be a legit scary team to go against.
Yeah.
Hell yeah, for sure. That'd be right.
Ron Francis, if you're watching this, sir, make it happen.
Yeah.
I know it'll be only your second season, but it wouldn't hurt to make a lot of noise while you're still young, you know?
Right. Well, I got to say, you know, Francis has actually done a good job with drafting with them and running that team. But I got to say, Seattle right now is making the Vegas Golden Knights look like a laughing stock. Oh, wait, Vegas already did that on their own.
Vegas is a fucking disaster. I mean, nobody wants to play for them right now. And it's crazy that people are willing to go to Seattle over Vegas. That speaks volume about the franchise right now.
Especially Vegas is on the no trade clause list. I mean, oh man. And we weren't even seeing that up until this year.
I think so. I mean, they traded Patrick Reddy for nothing and they traded away Fleury for nothing. So that kind of explains it. And they don't treat their players too well either, which really speaks volume. And that Jack Eichel contract is coming back to bite them in the ass.
Yeah. And even a lot of Vegas fans don't even like the fact Eichel's there. So.
Oh, well. Tough shit.
Yeah.
So, but Sean, what was your initial reaction when you found out the Bjornstrand trade?
I was at a loss for words, to be honest. Like, dude, you want to talk about making a statement? This is a freaking statement right here. Like, geez.
Yeah, the Kraken fans are going to really like this guy. I can tell you that right now.
Oh, I have no doubt about that.
They're going to like this guy. Yeah. And you know what? He'll help you put the puck in the net for sure. I mean, and that was something.
Oh, yeah.
They needed help in their scoring chances. I mean, bringing Burakovsky is great and all, but he can't do it all by himself. But then again, when you look at your top six, You have Burkowski. You have Jordan Eberle. You have now Oliver Bjorstrand. And then you have Shane Wright and Matty Beniers coming up. And you probably had the best draft out of everybody.
There you go. Yeah. What else can be said about that?
Yeah, I mean, you guys did great with everything. I mean, and especially, yeah, I know you guys traded a lot of players in, like right before the end of the season at the trade deadline. But, I mean, it worked out for the best, really, in this case, because of the fact that, I mean, well, landing Bjorkstrand was great, but just everyone that's coming in now, I mean, you have a legit solid top six right off the bat. And the defense is good, too. I mean, you have some very good players on defense. And I mean, I've always liked Vince Dunn when they chose him as one of their top draft picks.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing. I mean, that was like a perfect cornerstone to build around. And then Bjorkstrand is going to be one of those guys on one of your forwards, basically perfect guy to build around. And of course you have Eberle, you have everybody there. So now I could see, I don't know. And this is one thing that Bobby had mentioned earlier. And I agree with this point. I don't know if they'll be in the playoffs this year, but they're going to be a hell of a lot of fun to watch.
Mm-hmm.
They're definitely going to be better for sure.
Oh, yeah. I mean, honestly, and I was just going to say, I was just going to say that this might be a legitimate chance for Seattle to make it to the playoffs. I don't see them making it, but the way they've been drafting and trading, it is a huge possibility though.
Oh yeah, without a doubt. I mean, we can definitely say the same thing about what happened with Calgary on Friday too. We're actually in the middle of talking about that trade. Did you see that deal by any means?
No, I didn't. I was just a little too focused on the Bjorkstrand trade.
Fair enough. It's all good. But yeah, Kachuk got traded to Florida.
Oh gosh.
Yeah, Matthew Kachuk got traded for a ransom. You want to hear the return?
I'm listening.
This happened on the night of my wedding. Keep this in mind. Same with the Bjornstrand trade. That actually happened during the cocktail hour. So for those who I was trying to tell the rest of the details to, the Calgary Flames are getting Jonathan Huberdeau, Mackenzie Weegar, prospect Cole Schwinn from the 2019 draft, and a conditional 2025 first-round pick, and the pick is top 10 protected. In return, the Florida Panthers are getting Matthew Kachuk and a 2025 fourth-round pick, which is conditional. It could become a third if the Flames – are a legit playoff team in the next 2 years.
Wow, that's a mouthful.
Yeah, and get this. If the Flames, let's say, scenario, like, don't make the playoffs because they made it a pretty good playoff run, I mean, until they ran into Edmonton, in the nightmare offseason they've had with losing both Johnny Gaudreau and Matthew Kachuk, they at least have something to work with here. It's not the complete end of the world, but if Calgary underperforms like they did this past year in the playoffs, they're going into a rebuild. So for the sake of argument, and I told Tom this earlier, and I said, if Jonathan Huberdeau and Mackenzie Weegar choose not to stay in Calgary by February, which is the trade deadline next coming year in 2023, they can get foot for assets. And the Flames can use that going forward as part of their assets. And they have a conditional first round pick in 3 years from now.
Wow.
Yeah. And afterwards, Matthew Kachuk also agreed to an extension, which is the first ever in the history of the NHL. It's the first ever sign and trade deal, which is you often see in the NBA or in the NFL. Mm-hmm. And that is Matthew Kachuk is getting an 8-year deal worth $9.7 million with the Florida Panthers. My God.
Yeesh.
Yeah. And we're talking about one of the best offensive players in the league in Matthew Kachuk.
Wow.
And one of the things I'll say, I mean, Florida definitely addressed a lot of what they needed too after getting blown out in the playoffs. So,
oh, yeah, certainly. I mean, they needed help on the offensive scheme.
Yeah.
My theory as to why this trade happened is, and I firmly believe this, is the Panthers felt that they did not have the cap space to re-sign Huberdeau. If they did, then they would have hands down been able to extend them long term because Huberdeau and Weegar are both free agents in 2023. So maybe the Panthers felt that they didn't have the cap because you have to keep in mind they're also paying $10 million for the next 4 years for Sergei Bobrovsky. So that's going to really hurt them there. And now they're going to be able to pair up Matthew Kachuk with Sasha Barkov. Jesus Christ.
Oh, man.
Good gosh.
That's going to be a fun pairing to watch.
Yeah, and you know what's funny, too? The Panthers also have one of the best offensive, groups in the league. I'm actually on Cap Friendly right now as we speak. Let me read you this chart. They have Sasha Barkov, Matthew Tkachuk, Sam Reinhardt, Patrick Hornfist, Sam Bennett, Carter Vegahay, Anthony Duclair, and then they have E2 Ulster-Reinen, and then they have Colin White, Nick Cousins, Anton London, or Anton Lundell, excuse me, and then Ryan Lomberg and Rudolph Balchers. And then on defense, they have Aaron Ekblad, Brandon Montour, Gustav Forsling, Radek Gudas, Lucas Carlson, and Mark Stahl. And then, of course, their 1-2 punch is Sergei Bobrovsky and Spencer Knight.
That's a pretty solid team right there.
Absolutely.
And of course, since we're talking about Calgary, everyone can probably remember the 2014 entry draft when Calgary Flames drafted Sam Bennett.
Yep, and the Sabres drafting Sam Reinhardt. And by some coincidence, all three of them in the top five are on the Florida Panthers roster. Aaron Ekblad, Sam Reinhardt, and Sam Bennett are all on the Florida Panthers together.
Right. Very true. And it was interesting because I think Hanifin was drafted that year also, and he was traded not that long ago after spending some time with Carolina. So
no, Hanifin was drafted the next year.
All right, that's right, 15.
Yeah, 15 it was. But no, so as of now, the Florida Panthers have a negative $3.35 million in cap space. So they're $3 million over the cap from the Tkachuk trade.
Yeah, so, I mean, some minor moves here and there, but I mean, good job by Florida, though.
Oh, absolutely. Their top six is scary good next year.
Yeah.
And then what's the crazy part about all this, too, is the Florida Panthers will not have a first-round pick until 2026.
Unless they end up flipping some other assets at some point, but.
Well, yeah, they flipped the first rounder for Sam Reinhardt. They flipped the first rounder for Claude Giroux. They flipped the first rounder to get Matthew Tkachuk. And then I think they flipped another first to get Ben Chiarot. And then who are now free agents.
Yeah, but I'll tell you one thing, though. They addressed what they needed to, because, I mean, I still remember them versus Tampa. I'm like, holy crap, get blown out in four.
Absolutely. Sean, what do you think about the Tkachuk trade?
And that's definitely something, man. Man, you want to talk about making waves, man. Stuff like that. Ooh, all kinds of waves.
Yeah, I mean, this could very well be a Jekyll and Hyde trade for the Florida Panthers, because they could look at this and they could say, okay, we have Matthew Tkachuk. We have one of the best top six forwards in the league. If not one of the best top 20 best players in the league, period. Maybe top 30. And sure enough, he's coming to Florida. He's coming to Sunrise, and he's going to play with Alexander Barkov. So maybe those two could be the next Crosby and Malkin within the Atlantic Division. But I will say this, don't count out the Florida Panthers yet.
No, I wouldn't. And actually, the thing I'm going to like to see this season is that rivalry between Tampa and Florida, see how that plays out, because Florida's a better team already this year.
They're definitely not better than Tampa overall, though.
Well, Tampa still has such a deep system. It's absolutely insane. But Florida definitely will give them a run for the money, though.
Absolutely, without a doubt. But you know what? I will say, for the long term, the wild card player in this deal is Cole Schwinn, because he hasn't even scratched the surface yet. And he was a 2019 prospect. Not a first rounder, though, but he was definitely – I think he was a third round pick in 2019. So for him to be in the deal could really benefit Calgary if he develops well. So there's a lot of moving parts about all this. And I mentioned it earlier on the show, is if Huberdeau decides to stay in Calgary long-term, he'll get a contract. Same with Mackenzie Weegar. But both of them are UFAs in the end of next summer. So it could be a ride or die deal for Calgary, or it could be a ride or die deal for Florida. This could go both ways.
Yeah. And it actually reminds me what you're talking about with Schwinn. It reminds me of when the Sabres ended up shipping Eichel out to Vegas, and we end up getting Pitt and Krebs in return. And Krebs turned out to be an absolute nightmare for a lot of people playing against him. And just with how he developed really quickly and how he was able to get in and stay up in the big club.
Absolutely. I mean,
it could very well be that type of scenario. And Krebs was a ton of fun to watch.
Oh, yeah.
Especially when he got his shot up here, he made the most of it.
Well, yeah, Krebs was a first-round pick, though. Schwinn is a third-round pick. And I'm not saying that Schwinn can't be a good player. He definitely has the ability to be. But it really just depends how the Flames handle him. Because the Panthers, there was no room for him, especially with that top nine. Absolutely not.
Right. Yeah. And like we said, as long as he develops well, he could turn out to be a really good pick overall.
I agree. Holy shit, that was a mouthful to talk about.
I mean, yeah.
Awesome. But
if you had to pick a winner, y'all, who do you think is going to win that trade?
I'm thinking right now, Florida wins the trade.
Florida?
Yeah, I was just going to say Florida.
At least on the short term, they win the trade.
I'm going to give it.
I still think Florida has the edge on it. But if Schwinn develops the way he is, and if Huberto stays in Calgary, it could actually work out pretty well.
Yeah, I'm going to give it to Calgary only because if Huberto and Uyghur decide, I don't want to stay in Calgary, and they miss the playoffs next year, they at least get a really good return for both of them. And, you know, they can get multiple first-round picks for both of them combined.
Yeah, I was going to say, both are well worth first-rounders.
Without a doubt. I mean, especially Huberto. Huberto, you know, it's kind of embarrassing.
He's the first round, if not more than one first rounder.
Yeah, and the funny thing about the Huberto thing was he didn't even know the trade happened until it went public.
Wow.
He was not notified about the trade until, you know, the Calgary Flames PR team said, we acquired Jonathan Huberto from the Florida Panthers. And then he's just like, yo, I am not staying in Calgary. And then in this press conference, it's like, yeah, I'm going to stay in Calgary, or I'd like to stay in Calgary long term. Well, okay. Well, if they could build around Huberto, great. But it really, like I said, this is a huge gamble for a team like the Panthers. When you're a cup contender, you have all the pieces in place for you. And now all of a sudden you get one of the best top six forwards in the league in Matthew Tkachuk. And I'll tell you, Panthers fans are going to get a really good player out of him if he turns into what he was playing with under Johnny Gaudreau, but only with Sasha Barkov.
Right. Yeah, very true. Very true.
Without a doubt.
But what we're going to do is, of course, we're about a half hour into the show already, so we're going to go into our second half. And, of course, if you guys want to give us a call, 929-205-6099 gets you on the air. And we're going to switch over to football because, of course, got two things we're going to talk about. First, I want to talk a little bit about the Buffalo Bills training camp, but the one thing I know that we got to see a little bit earlier, and I'm going to show everybody this, is the LA Rams have their Super Bowl rings.
It is a beautiful.
Oh, yo. It is. Look at that.
That is a beautiful ring.
Wow.
And the funny thing is, it's a removable top. So in the inside, I think there's a picture Tom might have, is there's a picture, or not a picture, there's a piece of jewelry inside the ring if you take the top off. It's an actual frame of SoFi Stadium.
What?
Yeah.
Wow.
You know what? Now that I mentioned it, let me actually bring it up because I just had that on my phone thinking Tom had it, but nope. I always got to come prepared, right? Let me see if I can get the ring. There it is. I don't know if you can see this too well, but God, stupid thing. Let me actually take the background off so you guys can see it better. There we go. Come on. There it is.
Oh, wow.
That's the inside of the ring.
I've never seen a freaking Super Bowl ring like that before.
Me neither.
Holy crap.
And here's the other side with Aaron Donald on it.
Nice. Customizing everything.
It's a really nice ring.
That's got to be one of the nicest ones I've seen. And I've been to Canton before. I've seen the Super Bowl rings that they have in the Hall of Fame there, but that's got to be like one of the nicest I've ever seen.
Hands down. That was one of the best ones. But do you think it's possible too? I mean, let's talk about the Bills, but there's actually something I want to talk about with Kyler Murray. I want to get to that in a little bit.
Oh, God. Like I say, it's Arizona. Why the hell did you make Kyler Murray the second highest player in the league?
For real. Why'd you give him all that money that he didn't deserve?
Yep. And you want to hear something else? There's actually a clause in his contract that says that he has to do a mandatory studying for 4 hours per day on film.
Oh, boy.
So let me get this straight, and I'll play devil's advocate on this one. So they're saying mandatory 4 hours a day studying film. Are they saying that he's brain dead, basically, and he can't grasp the offense?
Well, apparently, by context, yes.
And he can't grasp a defense?
By apparently.
You're paying him all this money?
You're paying him 230 fucking million and you're guaranteeing him 160 million. And yet there's a clause that says, like, you have to do your homework, Kyler, or you can't go outside and play with your friends.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Remember
what are you thinking, Arizona?
I've never heard of that before.
Yeah. So imagine this in your head, if y'all can do it, is imagine in your head when you were younger in your teenage years, your mom would get grouchy at you and they would say, Sean, Bobby and Tom, or whoever in this case, I'll use myself, for example. You'd be like, okay, Bobby, if you want to go outside, you have to study. Okay. No video games, no laptop, no nothing, no phone, no nothing. You got to study. You're failing grades, buddy. I mean, I didn't fail, but them just using an example. So, right. And I'm failing in English, for example, and I have to study. And instead of doing all that, you say, yeah, I'm studying. You're on your phone and you're on your Xbox or PlayStation or whatever. And you come back and you'll be like, it's in your contract. You have to study, okay? And then you keep going on and on and on, basically. And Kyler Murray is just basically being told, like a little kid, you have to study. You got to put the video games away and you have to learn the offense.
Dude, that's embarrassing, man.
Not only is that embarrassing, if I'm an Arizona Cardinals fan, I would be really concerned.
Right? Yeah.
And I mean, right off the bat, Kyler Murray has done absolutely nothing. And I mean, nothing to deserve that amount of money. Right,
exactly.
I mean, sure. Has he had some flashes here and there? Yeah, he has. That game against the Bills, that was a fluke.
Yes.
He didn't win.
Absolutely.
He did nothing to win that team. That was a fluke Hail Mary that somehow ended up being caught, luckily.
Now, unbelievable.
But any other time we've played him, we've destroyed him. And a lot of other teams have done the same thing. So at the end of the day, he's not better than Aaron Rodgers. He's not better than Josh Allen. He's definitely not better than Patrick Mahomes. Hell, I don't know.
Not even close.
He's not even better than Lamar Jackson.
But
that's saying a lot.
But I will say this, though. Considering the status of the NFC West right now, he's arguably the second best quarterback, if not the best quarterback in that division. He's right up there with Matthew Stafford, but Stafford has accomplished a hell of a lot more than Kyler Murray has.
Well, yeah, Stafford's got a ring on him, but they also built a good team around him.
Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, shouldn't Arizona be in this argument too? I mean, you're basically paying him a whole load of money to be your franchise quarterback, and you have to get him a set of rules. Imagine if the Buffalo Bills one day said to Josh Allen, okay, if you want all this, if you want to make $43 million a year, you're going to have to sit out for 4 hours a day and do the playbook and learn it.
Jeez. You shouldn't have to be told that in the contract.
For real.
Yeah. Imagine what kind of confidence would you have in him? I know.
You have, there's no confidence.
Right.
If you put that in a contract, that means you have no confidence in the quarterback.
No. And what's even worse is Kyler Murray threatened a trade and he was requesting, you know, making a big dramatic scene on Instagram. And he was saying, oh, realize. Oh, I got to realize I have to do what's best for me. Blah, 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 blah. Like every dramatic player in the NFL, Antonio Brown, Kyler Murray, Dez Bryant, etc. You name it. Anybody who's influenced by social media, Kyler Murray of all people is a good example of this. And he basically is just like, all right, if I don't get what I want, I'm just going to delete my posts on Instagram, delete the Arizona Cardinals and all that. And he'll say, it's nothing personal. I'm like, yeah, it seems personal, buddy, because you're making a bitch fit of it on Twitter.
Right.
Yep.
And yet he thinks he's supposed to be handed all this money hand over fist, and he hasn't done a damn thing to prove it.
No. He hasn't. I mean, he's lucky that the Arizona Cardinals have DeAndre Hopkins. He's lucky the Arizona Cardinals have a decent run game. He's lucky the Arizona Cardinals have a decent offensive line. Because
he's
without
lucky that they
line,
got TJ Watt on the defense.
And he's extremely lucky that he has Zach Ertz to throw to, because who else is he going to throw the football to?
He's got nobody.
DeAndre Hopkins is out for six games. Christian Kirk got $84 million for the fucking Jaguars for whatever reason. He didn't deserve that money. And then not even close. And then what else happened? Who else did Arizona have that's on the roster? I was going to say Rondale Moore. Is he a wide receiver or is he a running back? I think he's a wide receiver. I'm pretty sure. He's got to be a wide receiver.
Yeah, he is a wide receiver.
Yeah.
Honestly, I don't know what to think of this. Independent studying film per week for 4 hours. And it's mandatory too.
Any football, well, actually, let me take this back. Any pro player should not have to have that in their contract. They should just know.
Yeah, you're supposed to earn that contract, but imagine being so fucking mediocre that you have to be told that you have to do mandatory studying like a teenager just to learn the playbook for your shitty, you know, football team.
Wow. Dude. I mean, God, and I was thinking Mahomes' contract was a little crazy when it first came out. This one's even way worse. At least the Mahomes one now makes sense.
And you know what, though? Like, I will say this. With Allen's contract getting $43 million, he's making more than Kyler Murray. I mean, he's making less than Kyler Murray. And Kyler Murray didn't do shit in the first 3 years. I mean, yeah, making the playoffs is one thing. But Arizona also had a really cupcake schedule, you know, where they were able just to walk right through the first seven opponents and, you know, and become mediocre afterwards. So, to me, the Arizona Cardinals are absolutely nobodies. They're just hot garbage. They truly are.
Yeah. In fact, here you go, guys. Here's the contract.
Oh, gosh.
Yep. Oh, God. Independent study added in between Arizona Cardinals club and Kyler Murray player for the contract of 2022 to 2027 and a club option in 2028. Jesus Christ. Can you make that bigger if you can?
Yeah, I can, unfortunately. That's just as big as that image goes.
Fuck.
But here's what it says. So the independent study addendum is attached to and forms a part of the NFL player contract between Kyler Murray and the Arizona Cardinals Football Club. The addendum modifies the contract only to the extent specifically set forth herein. And all the other respects of the contract, including any other addenda thereto, remains unchanged and full of force and effect. Terms defined in the contract shall have meanings given to them in the contract when used in this addendum. So here's part 36. Player agrees to satisfy the following off-field requirements. 1, player shall complete at least 4 hours of independent study as defined below each week, excluding any bye week during each playing season as defined below during the term of the contract.
Oh,
2, the playing season means the period beginning on the first Monday after the conclusion of training camp as defined in Article 23, Section 10 of the CBA, and ending with the last game on the club schedule, including any postseason games during each year. 3, independent study, in quotes, means player studies the material provided to him by the club in order to prepare for the club's next upcoming game, including without limitation any such material provided by an iPad or other electronic device. Time spent in mandatory meetings shall not constitute independent study. Players shall receive no credit for independent study for any period during which a player does not personally study the provided material in good faith. For the avoidance of doubt, the player shall not receive any credit for independent study with respect to any time periods during which any material is displayed or played on an iPad or other electronic device if A, the player is not personally studying or watching the material while it is being displayed or played, or B, player is engaged in any other activity that may distract his attention. For example, watching TV, playing video games, or browsing the internet while such material is being displayed or played. 4, in the event the player breaches this addendum in any respect at any time during the term of the contract, the player shall be deemed to be in default as that term is defined in paragraph 27 of the contract.
Wow.
Oh my gosh.
Wow. Imagine that. Imagine having so much less faith. You know, if I'm an Arizona Cardinals fan, I would be shared skitless, shitless for this. I honestly would be. Because, again, if that contract was given to someone like Patrick Mahomes or Josh Allen, I don't think anybody in the league would respect them. But for the Arizona Cardinals to be this incompetent, it clearly shows to me that the Cardinals – have no faith in him whatsoever. And they're exclusively telling him, you could only use our playbook, not the way you want it.
Ugh. Let's see. Patrick Mahomes doesn't need that contract. Aaron Rodgers doesn't need that contract. Tom Brady 12 doesn't need that contract. Josh Allen 17 doesn't need that contract. Lamar Jackson doesn't even need that in the contract.
But Lamar Jackson doesn't have a contract, though.
Well, still, he wouldn't even need it in there.
actually, I wouldn't know, because Lamar Jackson, they might say to him, hey, you can't run.
Well, then it takes away 90% of their offense, but
yeah.
Even still, it's like these QBs don't even need that in there. Hell, even Tua probably doesn't even have it in his contract, and look at that, what he's done for Miami, which is almost next to nothing.
Yeah, and Tua is under one more year or his third year of a rookie contract, because I think a rookie contract at minimum is 4 years with a fifth year option. So I honestly don't know what to think at this point. I mean, the fact that the Arizona Cardinals have to put this much energy into one player really solidifies everyone else. So, oh boy, who we got here? Bobby's mom is like, is that Adam?
Maybe.
Do it.
You had to come on for the fun festivities for the last one of the season, huh?
Oh.
Hey, what's up, Adam?
I had to make an appearance.
Nice.
You goddamn right.
Good stuff.
I'm glad you made it.
How's it going, man? It's been a while since we talked to you.
Going good, I guess. Not too bad. I'm expecting a newborn here shortly.
Very nice. Congrats.
Wow. Man. Okay.
Yeah, another fucking dependent. Just what I need.
Wow.
There you go, man. Well, good for you, man. Good for you. But I gotta say, man, for the last time this season, what you got smoking over there today?
I am doing a Northern Lights Kush. It's a indica. It's a pretty good, let's say.
There you go. All right, good stuff, man. Well, as I was gonna say, it's like the thing we were just talking about, and feel free to jump in on this if you want. Kyler Murray, we were just talking about how he's got that film study part of his contract where he got massively overpaid for nothing.
Well, I sent a thing to Bobby like yesterday or the day before stating that Kyler Murray makes more in 1 year than the whole Oakland A's organization.
That's really sad.
God.
Yeah, it is.
No joke. It's a real thing. Like the Oakland A's have like 44.3 million in contracts, and Kyler Murray makes 46.1 or whatever the fuck he makes.
That's a lot of money.
Wow.
I mean, for even for the A's, that's very under, you know, that's very underwhelming.
It's a whole fucking team, though. It's a whole team of players. That's not just one player. That's a whole team.
Yeah. And just to think about this, and actually I'm glad you mentioned the Oakland A's, because I want to throw this point in there real quick, and then we'll jump back to Kyler Murray. But the Oakland A's are so cheap that they didn't even fly their lone all-star, Paul Blackburn, on first class. The Houston Astros actually flew him on first class.
What?
Yeah, they got some cheap-ass fucking owners.
Like the Oakland Seals all over again.
Yeah, like literally, Houston offered to fly Oakland's player because Oakland didn't want to pony up anything.
Do you remember the movie Moneyball?
Yes.
With Brad Pitt? Yeah, it's the same dilemma right there.
It's the same story.
Yeah, it basically is. They couldn't pay worth a shit for their team, and they were like the... But they made it work. It was a real story, so I don't know.
It's insane.
Yeah, and it was on Houston's chartered plane on top of it that they were going to fly Paul Blackburn. Basically, the A's wanted to fly him commercial. Coach.
Yeah, you know, a little bit of humility doesn't hurt with athletes every now and then, but Oakland is really cheap.
Right.
Oh, absolutely. It's even more humiliating when you have a quarterback who has to take a mandatory studying session for 4 hours a day just to learn the offense for a shitty team.
Well, I also heard the coach, what's his name that coaches the Cards?
Cliff Kingsbury. Cliff
Kingsbury.
Yeah, he apparently tweeted out that Kyler Murray has a 9:30 bedtime on work days.
Oh, my God. Jesus Christ.
That's a legit thing. Like, Google it, you'll see it. He actually said that on work days is a 9:30 bedtime for delivery.
9:30 bedtime. That is so idiotic. First, they tell him that you can only study for a certain amount of hours per day. Like, he's a little kid getting in trouble.
He tried to say it was like a clause in the contract, was that he had to be in bed by 9:30 on work days.
That's so stupid. He's being treated like a little kid.
Well, he's a little fucking kid.
He is. He acted like a bitch all offseason. He had like a bigger bitch when he threatened to get traded or request a trade. And now, because the Cardinals don't know what to do, they paid him a ransom amount of money to be the second highest paid quarterback in the league. And then they put in a clause that says you have to study like anything else. Like if you're a regular kid at school, and now they make you go to bed at 9:30 at night. So what the fuck are they doing? I have never heard of this before with anybody in any sport.
Here's an interesting thing. So ProFootballTalk.com, Kyler Murray admitted last year he doesn't watch film.
Maybe that's why he's so overrated. But yeah, that's probably why he got his ass kicked in the playoffs.
Maybe why he has a bitch of an arm, a little bitch arm.
The Hail Murray.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It never should have happened.
And even there on the bottom comment right there.
You know what boils my blood? Actually, I'll put this in Peter Griffin fact. You know what really grinds my gears is the fact that Kyler Murray makes more than Josh Allen. That's fucking
unreal. Josh Allen's like number five.
Gosh.
but
how?
The thing is though, I think Josh Allen took a team friendly fucking contract,
right?
Which made sense, and he's a team player. Kyler Murray's a little bitch. And he's like, oh, I want my money. It's like that fucking guy in Kansas City. He's like, I didn't ask for 24-5. I asked for 25. Who's the guy that like is holding on a contract right now for Kansas City, offensive tackle?
Right. Well, our friend here, Joey Hatch, has some comments in the chat. So I'm going to go over that. So basically, he said, when you sign on the dotted line, it's like going into the military. They own your ass. I hate to say it like that. Well, Adam, you are in the military, so I mean, I know you could speak to that. But then he also says, well, when you pay somebody that kind of money, you want to make sure they don't do dumb crap and break their arm and can't play the season, so they have to have clauses in the contract. Then he also ends up saying something about rainbow belts, and I don't know what he's talking about on that.
Well, okay.
Rainbow belt.
Yeah, go ahead, Adam.
Okay, so on the military aspect, okay. Technically, they own your ass. But at the same time, when you're in the military, you're just a fucking number. When you're a quarterback, you're the reason they're relevant. So, it's a total different fucking aspect.
Yeah. Military, completely different beast compared to an NFL quarterback. Like, the military, it's required to be in shape. It's required that you stay focused. It's part of the job. It's part of the requirement. This is a guy who's literally the height of me in this instance. He's probably taller by 2 inches than me, and he's playing a kid's game. That says a lot. And he has to be treated like he's getting in trouble in high school. Oh, you can't play video games unless you do your homework, son. Oh, you have to be in bed by 9. Like, this is an NFL quarterback.
It just goes to show how high his maturity rate is, right? If a coach has to say something like that, then...
Right. That's just sad, man.
It shouldn't have to happen.
Holy crap. It's just freaking sad.
And I told the guys, and I said, you know, if I'm an Arizona Cardinals fan and I saw that in the contract, I would be really concerned because you're giving him a load of money to play a game and he has to get treated like a teenager.
Yeah. And a lot of the fans are upset about it. And then and actually Hatch ends up commenting here too. Hey, Joey, call in if you want, 929-205-6099. And actually, Joey, I sent you the link in the chat, in chat I have with you, so go ahead and call in if you want. But he says, I don't understand the whole being in bed by 9:30. The next thing you know, you're going to want me to wear a diaper.
Well, in all reality, he's still a fucking kid. And the coach obviously wants to treat him like a fucking child. Mm-hmm. And in the long run, I really don't think that's going to help his demeanor. It's not going to help him in general. Although, you know, he's probably got a big chip on his shoulder all of a sudden now, because like, oh, I'm the $46 million fucking quarterback. Well, money talks, but at the same time, your little bitch arm has to talk too. So,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right.
That's like if Lamar Jackson got a similar contract, but more than Kyler Murray. But in the contract, it would say, if you want this money, you can't run.
Yeah. See, that's what I mean. Like, it's a double-edged sword, right? So right. you can't be like, hey man, like, we'll give you the 46 mil, but if you see a fucking 10-yard fucking touchdown in your sight, you can't run it. You have to knee every time. Like, no quarterback can do that unless you're Tom Brady, a little bitch, and stays in the pocket all the time.
Mm-hmm. Right, exactly. And here's a take I'll throw out there. My prediction right now is that the Arizona Cardinals GM and the coach Cliff Kingsbury, they're going to be fired within 3 years.
I think the coach, I think he'll be fired halfway through the season.
It depends on how Arizona plays out, because Arizona really shot themselves in the foot, because DeAndre Hopkins is a dumbass for taking PEDs and he's suspended for 6 games.
Yep.
Christian Kirk is a fucking moron for taking $84 million by Jacksonville of all people. And then the only thing that he's throwing the ball to is to freaking Zach Ertz and Hollywood Brown. And I think Hollywood Brown, as we speak, is injured for the time being.
Yeah, he's going to be fucking hit and miss. He's like another, you know, he could have a couple of good games and he could be like Hall of Famer, and all of a sudden he's gone for the rest of the season. So,
yeah, it's ridiculous.
I wouldn't bank too much on him.
Mm. Speaking of ridiculous stories that's going around in the NFL, did anybody see the rumor about Jimmy Garoppolo soon to be traded?
Yeah, I saw a post where the Niners were moving on with Trey Lance and going away from Jimmy Garoppolo. I'm like, wow.
They kind of have to at this point.
In all reality, it's not. It's Trey Lance time. It's not fucking Garoppolo time. It's fucking time for him to fuck off somewhere.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And some other team could use Garoppolo, so.
Yeah, it's he'd be
a good backup quarterback. I would take him over Sam Darnold.
Oh yeah, of course you would take anybody over Sam Darnold. Maybe. Well, hang on. You got Baker Mayfield. He's gonna get the job regardless. And now they're saying that they're gonna split the reps for the first team in training camp between him and Darnold. But we already know who's gonna win that one. But
yeah, Mayfield will win that hands down.
Hands down.
Yep.
Okay. Now, still, we're on the topic of Kyler Murray. I'll bring up the fact that I sent Bobby a thing the other day about how Baker Mayfield's stats are probably better than Kyler Murray's.
By far.
By all means. Only thing he wins on is the quarterback rating. Other than that, Baker Mayfield's fucking stats are better than his, and he just got paid $46 million.
Yeah, so here's the stats that Adam's talking about. According to a guy by the name of Michael Rimmer, I don't know him, but he said in the tweet, in comparison between the two, between Kyler Murray and Baker Mayfield, in the first 3 seasons alone, he said Kyler Murray's record was 22-23-1 with 70 touchdowns and 34 interceptions, and the highest passer rating was 93.9, and he has an 0-1 record in the playoffs against the Rams. So that explains that. And if you compare that to Baker Mayfield, Baker Mayfield is 23-22 in the first 3 years with the Browns, and then he had 75 touchdowns, had 43 interceptions, and his passer rating was 89.4 percentage rating, and then his playoff record is 1-1, which was beating the Steelers and losing to the Chiefs.
Yeah, so $46 million got you a quarterback that's not proven, basically.
Yeah.
Well, I definitely would say I would take Baker Mayfield over Kyler Murray right now.
Oh, I would too.
All right, I wouldn't go that far. I wouldn't go that far. I wouldn't, if I put them head to head and like even teams, I still think Kyler Murray would edge him out, but he is a Heisman Trophy winner. I don't think Kyler Murray is.
Yeah, I think Kyler Murray did win the Heisman. I don't think so, but I could be wrong about that. I have to double check.
I know that Baker did, but I don't know if Kyler Murray did.
I don't think so either. I can look it up real quick. Let me see. Kyler Murray. Did he win the Heisman Trophy?
He did win it.
Oh, he did? What year?
2018.
2018, and he was drafted in 2019 by Arizona.
Yeah.
And when did fucking Baker win it? 2017.
That's gonna be interesting.
He won. Yeah, Baker Mayfield won in 2017.
Out of Oklahoma.
Yeah. Yep.
Holy crap!
I don't know. I'm anxious to see what he'll do. I know he'll do better than Sam Darnold because.
Anybody will do better than Sam Darnold.
I swear to God, they could bring back Cam Newton. He would do a better job.
Yeah, supposedly he was going to go to the Browns, but they ended up signing Josh Rosen instead.
Yeah, what a fucking...
Rosen being a bust.
It's 29-year-old guy that's been with, like, five different teams, and how does he keep getting signed? That's what I can't figure out.
Maybe because he's nice.
Well, I don't know. Maybe as a hot mom, everyone bangs her, I guess.
Man, to think we almost drafted him, man. Holy crap. I'm glad we didn't.
I can come up with on the top of my head to be like, hey, that's probably a good backup quarterback. No, he's terrible. He's like the worst epitome of – he's worse than Sam Darnold. And that's saying something.
Absolutely. But yeah. I will say, though, is there's been a lot of buzz – lately about Jimmy Garoppolo, though, because while we're on this topic, is supposedly the Giants and the Falcons are the front runners to get Jimmy G.
You know what? You know what I'd do? I'd flip Sam Darnold out right now, take Jimmy G. I'd do it in a heartbeat.
You would?
Yeah, fuck yeah, I would.
Or you could just do this. Baker Mayfield for Jimmy Garoppolo.
I'll keep Baker and I'll swap out Sam Darnold and a pick for Jimmy G.
Yeah, Seattle is not going to get Jimmy G. I don't think they want to trade him within the division. Unless your name is the Washington Redskins and you get Donovan McNabb. Who else? Who else?
I forgot about him.
who did the Ravens have as a backup right now?
Right now? Oh, yeah. God. I don't even know. I mean, who's the Ravens backup? I know it was Tyler Huntley last year. And then
yeah, he got moved, didn't he?
I think he did. I don't really remember. I got to look it up. I know or Tomcat actually in this case. But I definitely know for a fact that he was the starter for the last five games in the regular season because Jackson got hurt.
No, Baltimore actually tendered the offer for Huntley.
Okay, so he's still on the team.
Yeah.
Okay, well. I don't know. I was thinking maybe Jimmy G would be a option for them because I didn't think Huntley was still there, but.
No, Jimmy G would not be traded to the Ravens because at this point, I would think that with all the options, I think the Giants would make the most sense because this is a do or die for Daniel Jones because they given him enough weapons and they got a new head coach. Mm-hmm. So there's no excuse for him this year. If he doesn't perform or at least get the Giants to the playoffs, he's going to get cut.
Yeah.
This is it.
And I don't think, honestly, Daniel Jones is legitimately a starter anyways. So
I don't either.
I mean,
I didn't even know who that guy was until yesterday when I seen a tweet from the New York Giants. I'm like, who the fuck is Daniel Jones? Oh, he's their quarterback.
Yeah, he's that irrelevant.
Yeah, and the only reason what's so sad about Daniel Jones is he's only memorable for two reasons. One, for being drafted so goddamn high because David Gettleman, the GM of the Giants at the time, was high on drugs. And he's like, oh, Dwayne Haskins, may he rest in peace, was still there. And then Josh Allen, the linebacker, was still there. So it's like, who are we going to take here? I know, Daniel Jones out of Duke University. Fucking dumbass. And yeah. One other one, too, that made him famous is if you look it up on YouTube, it's hilarious, is there's a famous clip from a Thursday night football game during the pandemic season in 2020 against the Philadelphia Eagles. And Daniel Jones is just sprinting for within midway field.
You know, I remember.
Yeah. And he's maybe 15 yards from hitting the end zone. And
he lost his balance.
He tripped over himself.
That's the guy that tripped over his own foot.
Oh my gosh. How do you do that?
That is YouTube gold.
Fucking picks.
Yeah, and actually a couple last things before we wrap up, because we're actually in a little bit of OT right now. So Hatch also ends up commenting in a chat. He said the Browns get rid of Baker Mayfield for Watson, who's in trouble, and they go out and get one of the worst backups you can get in Josh Rosen. Laugh out loud, go good luck. Then he has a haha symbol, and then he said the Seattle Seahawks dumpster fire.
Well, they're not that bad, though. I don't think. I mean, I know that Drew Lock is there, but I don't think they're that bad.
They're not as bad.
They could be
as
a lot worse.
Browns are going to be. If Deshaun Watson doesn't play, and not, I think he's way overrated, anyways. But I even if he doesn't play for 6 to 8 games or whatever the fuck it may be, I the Browns are going to be like, I don't know. They still have weapons. It's not like they don't have weapons. So I don't know. You could be a bum of a quarterback and not, you know, still win. So I don't know. It'll be interesting to see. But on another note, I'll just point this out. Christian McCaffrey tweeted out today about he's never felt better in his career and he's ready to go. So I'm kind of pumped. I'm like, okay, well, let's hope you're not hurt by game 3 again, fucking out for the whole season again. But
right,
if he's saying that, he's never tweeted it out, like, that he's never felt this good in the world. So,
yeah. And I also just read, according to Ian Harrods on Twitter, in Pro Football Focus Fantasy, he just said that Christian McCaffrey, as of right now, he's now the number one ranked fantasy player this year going into the draft.
Yeah. Dude, I watched some of his training videos, like some of the camp, and dude, he looks fucking solid. He looks solid. What's the guy we drafted, the big offensive tackle?
I'm trying to think. Ike Iguanu, that's his name.
Dude, he runs him over like he's not even there. In the one video, he leaped over his face. And went for a touchdown. Like he looks good. He looks strong.
What about Baker?
Baker looks good too. He's got a good arm, dude. He's got good nice. good strength in his arm.
Absolutely. That's what the Panthers need. They need to bolster up that offense. They need to drill up that quarterback situation. I will be genuinely surprised if Baker Mayfield turns into 2020 versions of Josh Allen. I'm serious. I really do think that. If you look at the Carolina Panthers offense in general, they have a pretty good overall offense. They just have to stay healthy.
Right.
Well, I'll tell you what else looks good, too. The edge rush. Was it Braun? Is his name Braun?
No, Brian Burns.
Brian Burns. He looks – dude, he looks fucking – he looks good.
Oh, hell yeah. He
looks fucking good, dude. And he's solid, too. He's going to get some fucking some good shit this year.
He's been around for a while, but yeah, I can definitely agree with that. I mean, he got the nickname Spider-Man when he first got drafted. I remember that. And he's a big influence on Spider-Man. So I can't wait to see what the Panthers defense can do. Their defense is rock solid already. All they need is a quarterback, and Baker could very well be the guy.
Mm-hmm. Well, their offensive line was where they had the problem, right?
Yep.
It's a lot of the problem was right up front in the offensive tackle, and they shored up with the new pick they picked up, and plus they have, they shored it up pretty good. We'll see.
And it's funny. I will say in the comments, Joey Hatch decided to take a little shot at you, Adam. So here's two things he mentioned. He said, well, the first point is true. He said, Cleveland's going to ruin him anyway, so it doesn't matter how good he is. That's all Cleveland does is ruin quarterbacks, which is true. They did ruin Johnny Football. They ran out Baker Mayfield. And they've had a bunch of other irrelevant players. But then
the sexual assault charges,
exactly. And then he said about to report that, and he's referring to Christian McCaffrey on this, about to report that he was putting on his helmet and tore his left nut. Christian McCaffrey will be sitting on the bench again. His luck sucks.
Yeah, you know what? I'm not you know what, he's not wrong, because I can see it. I've been a Panthers fan for I don't know how long now, but every year it's been the same thing. McCaffrey gets 3-4 games in, and then he's got fucking leg issues or hip issues or ankle issues. Like it's never ending. But I'm hoping every other year that it's not going to be an issue, and the guy's a beast. He can catch the ball and run the ball as good as anybody in the league. So I don't know. We'll see.
Yep. Absolutely. So. Yeah.
And then real quick before we wrap up, I just want to talk a little bit about Bills training camp, and then we'll do a shout out to Big Poppy here. But Bills training camp's been looking pretty good so far. So Josh Allen actually threw for 7 touchdowns today in camp. So he's finally getting, so the offense is finally showing up and doing what they need to, which is good. Allen's looking good. Kudos to him for a kid who had nothing to sign. He gave him signed game worn cleats. He took the cleats right off in front of him, signed them, and gave them to the kid. So that was pretty cool. And then James Cook, the rookie running back, is looking real good right now. And a couple of things that have come out is that, for one, very strong in the running game. But the other thing that's really turning out good about him is that they said really good hands as a pass catcher, and he can run the routes really good. And then the other thing that came out, Gabe Davis is going to be a legit number two wide receiver right behind Stephon Diggs, because the way that he's playing right now, he's basically, they're saying this is his breakout year.
I agree.
Well, yeah. Fuck me. I'll put Stephon Diggs on a fucking pedestal, because the guy's so underrated. He's so not appreciated, but I guarantee you now, if I get a chance to draft that guy in the fucking fantasy football, I'm fucking taking that.
Oh, yeah. I would too.
I'm taking that guy all day. I'll take him over DJ Moore. Mm-hmm. And the fact is, he's just a better wide receiver.
Yeah. So. And Diggs has been looking pretty good so far too. But the one thing I love about my fantasy league is it's a keeper league. So I get to keep 7 and I get to keep 6 or 7. And I have to draft 10 or whatever it is. But, I'm glad I drafted Josh Allen a couple years ago, because I've kept him and there's no way I'm getting rid of him. So I've got him in
Are we doing a fucking fantasy league this year or no?
We can definitely talk about it for sure.
Yeah, we could.
Yeah. I'd be in, because I'd be gunning for Josh Allen right off the hub.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can definitely discuss it for sure.
Right. Yeah, but it's good to see James Cook actually really doing well early in camp, though. So I mean, I'm really looking forward to see how that running back battle goes, because right now it's really between Singletary and Cook. I mean, Zach Moss, I think, is totally out of the picture as far as I'm concerned.
I don't think Singletary is elite. I think he's efficient. I don't think he's elite. I think Cook could be elite. I just don't think Singletary is the guy to go for elite running back. He's not.
Yeah. I mean, I've seen a lot of reports from training camp that said that James Cook is doing a lot of pass catching plays with Josh Allen, and he's mm-hmm. been really sufficient. But a lot of people have been saying that he's looking at very much a resemblance like his brother, which is a huge gimme to me.
That's a big compliment.
I've seen the one post about him, and it was, he has Velcro for hands. I don't know if you've seen that one.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, that was the big comment. Vocal, his hands are good.
Seven out of seven catches and in 7-on-7 or whatever. And he caught every catch.
Hell yeah. I mean, yeah. I'm telling you, James Cook is gonna be I guarantee you, somebody will draft him in this year's class, no matter who takes him in any league or anywhere. It doesn't matter who it is.
He'll be a dark horse, dude, and I'm telling you, he'll score a lot of points wherever it takes him.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. And you know what? There's even some contemplation about it too. But the fact that I would say, if you're going to take James Cook, I suggest making him as a number two running back and not a number one, because what if he doesn't pan out to be a number one running back for some reason?
Right. That's the same. It's the same as the guy. He's coming back for the Ravens. He was injured. Oh. And he was supposed to be out for the season, but now he's supposed to be on the pop list, but they fucking took him off, and I forget his name.
Yeah, you're thinking of J.K. Dobbins.
Yeah, Dobbins. That's another pick that you never know where it's going to go, and you know that if he's good, he's good, and if he's bad, he's bad, right? If he's hurt, he's hurt, but...
Yeah. It's going to be... This season alone is going to be wild. I can't wait.
Yeah, and it looks like Trey White's on schedule to return when he's supposed to, too. So, I mean, his knee's actually doing okay, and, I mean, he's been at camp. He's just doing a lot of light work right now, but once you get him back in...
You're talking about Tre'Davious White? Yeah. Talking about? Yeah. No, he's not a good asset for you guys.
Yeah, but but definitely love what I see out of James Cook so far. I mean, that is looking really good. And Von Miller has really had a strong camp so far.
Do you see his fucking Madden 23 rating?
I did.
He's like a fucking 97 or something, a 96 or 97.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, one thing that I will say that was really interesting before we wrap up is, and I know we keep saying that, and I apologize in advance, is Justin Jefferson made an ass of himself. And he, and as great as he is, I love Justin Jefferson, but he made a statement saying that, you know, Cooper Kupp is good and all, but I'm better than him, basically.
Yeah, well, yeah, you put the put your money where your mouth is, dude.
That's a lot coming from a guy who, like, that's legit coming from a guy who tore his ACL while doing the gritty.
That's like fucking Henry saying, I'm better than any running back in the fucking league after coming back after being injured and shit. It's like, you until you can fucking prove it, then don't talk shit.
Yeah, and it's funny because I remember maybe about 3-4 years ago when Jalen Ramsey was on the Jaguars, I remember Jalen Ramsey made an ass of himself and he was saying that he feels that he could be in the NHL within 6 months among any player, even over players that were in the juniors.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Like stick to football, buddy.
Yeah. That went well.
Yeah. For real.
Yeah. Seriously. But I will say, I mean, glad to see Von Miller doing well also. And the thing is, he's helping Bogey Basham and Gregory Rousseau play better and play above their potential too. So because the two of them have been doing a lot of work with Von Miller in camp so far in terms of their position, their technique and everything else. And he's helping coach them and guide them and sharing his knowledge of how he's won Super Bowl championships. So, I mean, that's going to be a big help, but I'm really looking forward to seeing more of what happens in training camp though, because right now, a lot of good people on this roster, but those are the standouts right now, are basically Rousseau, Miller, Basham working together. But James Cook, I legitimately think he could potentially knock out Singletary as the number one.
Depends on how he develops.
For sure. No, there's no doubt in my mind that he will.
No, without a doubt. So I think that's about it. As far
And last thing, David Ortiz, welcome to the Hall of Fame.
Yay, well overdue.
Yeah.
Way to go, big puppy.
Even though I couldn't stand you for all those years you've been beating up on my Yankees, but congrats on your Hall of Fame induction. Well deserved. Yeah. So
it is yeah. Well deserved. Even if you hate the guy, you can love to hate him.
Right. But he had a great career.
Yep. He did, for real. He did.
Yeah. And Sean, I have a question for you, buddy.
I can see where this is going, but go ahead.
New York Mets.
And
suck a dick.
He didn't give a reason.
Well, because this
I already know.
Because, well, for those who don't know, the Mets and the Yankees are fighting for first place in their respective divisions in the NL East and the AL East. And the winner has a double-edged lead in their division over their division rivals. And the Mets have already won last night, and they're up 2-0 in the bottom of the seventh against the Yankees at Citi Field.
Nice. Anyone see the score of the speaking of David Ortiz and the Boston Red Sox?
The Blue Jays when they won like 28-45.
Lace the fuck out of the fucking in three games, and the first game was like 25-8 or 25, whatever the fuck it was.
Oh my gosh,
he had like 12 runs in the fifth inning or some shit.
Yeah, it's insane.
Oh,
like the fifth highest score.
28-5.
Oh, that was. Oh my gosh. Seeing the
Red Sox. Yeah, that was on Friday the 22nd.
Am I watching a football game or it wasn't a fucking baseball game?
Yeah. In fact, here we go. I'll share this real quick. I mean, I don't even care. We're in overtime right now. It's our last show of the season. So,
right. So seeing the Red Sox get destroyed like I've never seen before. Was so freaking cathartic.
I think they used every pitcher they had the bullpen, plus they went back to another pitcher they already used.
Yeah.
The Red Sox was pathetic this year.
Yeah.
11 home runs in the freaking fifth inning for the Blue Jays.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So basically the Blue Jays, 28 runs, 29 hits, and 2 errors.
And you know what's even better? It was at Fenway Park.
Yeah, well, yeah, made it even better. Exactly. Yeah. In Fenway, yeah.
Yeah. But it's like, even the third inning, same thing. Seven runs in the third.
They played a three-game series, and Blue Jays beat them three games in a row. I think they beat them like 8-4 and something else after the fact.
Yeah.
But if you look at their record, like in the last like 15 games or something, they've been beat up badly by every team they played.
Yeah. Well, yeah, Boston is like 48-46 at that point.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, they've been doing terrible lately. I don't even really pay attention to baseball, but like after that, I was just like, my God, what is happening with your team?
You love to see it. You love to freaking see it.
Yeah, well, I seen a meme like the next day, and it was the picture of the Blue Jays and the Red Sox score, and on the bottom was a Simpsons meme, and it goes, "This is how you beat Boston." As a fucking Simpson character beating a Maple Leaf character.
Yeah,
that's how you beat Boston.
The bloody massacre. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, that was one of the worst beatdowns I've seen in baseball, and I can't even remember
it was one of the best. What you talking about?
No, I mean most lopsided.
It's the fifth highest scoring game in MLB history.
Oh, wow.
Right. Oh, man. It kind of reminds me, it's like if Big Papi were still on the Red Sox at that point, he would have probably done like he did in 2013, take the bat and smash the phone after he got ejected in that one game.
Yep.
I still remember that. That's one of my favorite clips, like watching him go off at it.
Sure.
Oh, man.
I remember that.
Yeah, that was classic right there.
Yeah, what did the phone do to you, Big Papi? It didn't do anything, but yeah. You earn that much money, you can take it out on a fucking $20 phone.
Right. So and actually Hatch asks another question here, and we'll wrap up shortly. But yes, are there any Sabres fans in the house? Are we going to take anybody in free agency or what?
No, they're going
to stay the course probably.
Just stay the course. Don't even go crazy. Just stick with your course and just build the team. Don't even worry about it.
Yeah, I mean, and they have a good young core coming up, so.
Yeah.
I don't think they're going to try to do, like, a whole ton with it.
I'll say this because I'm, like, the only non-Sabres fan in the fucking chat here. You know what? You did good. Actually, you did better in, like, goalie-wise than us because, you know, what the Leafs picked up. We picked up a fucking unproven, washed over fucking goalie and Murray. And then we're like, you know what? We'll just pick Samsonov just for backup, just in case. But yeah, Comrie. Comrie's more reliable than Anderson. Anderson's a veteran backup. You know what? It can only get better. It can't get worse. So.
Right. And Comrie's good pickup. If UPL gets healthy and starts playing. I mean, Devin Levi has been playing pretty well when he's had his opportunities.
Yeah, I think it'll be the 1-2 punch with Comrie and Anderson. I don't even think UPL will even get that much time this year, but I don't know. I feel like it'll be the 1-2 tandem, and it'll probably be Comrie taking most of the games and Anderson sitting back taking half.
Yeah.
But you never know.
Yeah. Comrie can put together a good streak, you know, that'll be a great thing for them. And I remember Andy ended up saying on the last show, he's like, bye-bye, Arundel. I'm so glad that he's out here.
Yeah. And by the way, thanks for Ilya Lyubushkin.
Yeah. 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 No problem.
I'll gladly take him.
Yeah. You know what? He's not that big of a deal. So.
Nope. Just a hard-hitting defenseman.
Yeah, well, you know, we picked up a few players. I think we'll be fine still.
Yeah,
I'm concerned about is the fact that we lost a little bit of grit. We lost Kasha, and yeah, we lost some grit.
And you lost your credibility with Jack Campbell.
Yeah, we lost Jack Campbell. Yes, that was the biggest hit to us. The fact was, though, is that Toronto offered Jack Campbell after they got rid of Mrazek's contract. They offered him 4.6 for 3 years, and he turned it down. He wanted a 5-year contract. The Leafs didn't want to give him a 5-year contract, which is understandable. He's a 2-year goalie that's been with the Leafs. Yeah, he had a really good year, but same time, you can't put that much money into a goalie that's injury prone, and you just can't. And Edmonton took the risk, and I'm sure he'll be fine there. But
we'll see.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I was gonna say, it's been a fun second season, and we're gonna be wrapping it up for this season after this show, and then, of course, the next show that we do, it's going to be our top 5 moments of season 2, and then we want to hear from you guys. What do you want to see for season 3? Because that'll be coming our way once we get in the football season. So we're going to be doing some stuff with that. One of the things we're looking at is possibly adding another co-host and doing some different things and possibly retooling a couple things on the show. But let us know. What do you think? What would you like to see? Or are there things you want us to keep around or anything like that? So, of course, we'll be doing that. But in the meantime, been a great season overall. We did like another 40 some episodes this season. So,
wait, am I being replaced?
No. We're looking to bring in more people for more balance.
Okay. Well, I'm just saying, if you want to replace me, it's fine.
No. Hell no. You're the family.
Let's see. I'm fucking irreplaceable. You can't replace me.
No, of course you're not being replaced.
Why would you ever think about that?
Come on, man.
You're family.
Right. More of anything, depending on my work schedule, I might be out a little bit more now than I used to be, but even still, we're still here.
Yeah, that's true.
It's all good. Still have a lot of good stuff to go over, so. But anyways, last couple comments, and Hatch was actually really active in the chat, so he says, I'm sorry, Vegas Golden Knights. Then he says, we got UPL and that other kid we just signed that we got from the Kings. Yep, we did talk about that. And I think the Buffalo Sabres picked up a defenseman. Yep, we talked about that too, so so that's where we're at. But
he needs to stop being a little bitch and come on sometime. You can be a chat warrior all you want, but you gotta learn to use your voice.
He said he's working right now, but he also says, keep the show as it is. I hate them podcasts where everyone sugarcoats everything.
We don't sugarcoat shit, dude.
That's the thing he likes about it.
Okay, so. Well, good, because I'm here not to sugarcoat shit.
Exactly. So, but I do want to say, for everyone that did watch the season, thanks for joining us. We appreciate it. We actually did go an hour and a half today, so it was a little longer than normal, but it's the last show of the season. And that's been one of the big things we've been trying to do this year, is to keep everything to about an hour or so and just make it easier to get through. So we're going to keep that, of course, going forward, and we'll have our little specials here and there where we go a little longer. But I want to say, guys, any last points before we sign off for the season?
Nope.
I got one. Happy birthday, Big Baller Bean.
Yes.
There you go. All right. Mm-hmm. And then Luffy, keep us up to date, man. Let us know when the little one comes around, and we'll have to give you a congrats on everything.
Fuck. I'll definitely keep you updated. When I get divorced again, I'll definitely keep you guys posted. But
at, man?
Same time, I'd like to put out that there's been a few episodes that I've been not around for and stuff, and I apologize for that. Not that anybody like cares that I'm for the audience wise, life happens. But I enjoy this. I enjoy talking sports. I enjoy shooting the shit, basically, and this is a good place to do it. And then. I'll keep doing it until I can.
Yeah, absolutely. And same here. I know I was out more this season than I was in season 1. It was just work commitments, things like that. I know I'm going to have some different things coming up with the job I got now, but But same thing, you know, we put this together because we wanted to be a no nonsense, to say whatever you feel type of show, and that's what's happening. So, you know, we're glad to bring it to y'all. And, you know, next week we'll do top five moments of season two. We'll take some time off, enjoy part of the summer, and then we'll come back around football season. And I have a funny feeling we're going to have a lot of wins and good things to talk about.
Well, on your side, maybe.
Well, at least you got, at least you don't have Sam Darnold really in as the
number. Yeah, well, that's what I mean. I have that. So,
all right.
We'll deal with that when it comes.
Yeah.
Yeah, very true. But in the meantime, guys, thanks for watching us all season. We appreciate it. Until next time, take care of yourselves and each other. We'll see you next time.
See you later.
Later.
Buffalo After Dark is an H&H studio production and is produced in partnership with Horns and Hooves Entertainment.